astronaut John Glenn of New Concord, Ohio. Lieutenant Colonel, United States Marine Corps. Married, father of two teenage children. Glenn has been a pilot over half of his 40 years, has flown in two wars, and is a veteran test pilot who 5 years earlier established a transcontinental flight record as the first man to average supersonic speeds across America. He volunteered for space flight, is one of seven astronauts selected for Project Mercury, the man in space program directed by the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Two teammates have pioneered the way into space for Glenn. Astronauts Alan Shepard and Virgil Grissom tested the Mercury spacecraft on trailblazing suborbital missions, proving the equipment and pushing the program to the threshold of orbital flight. And now, it's Glenn's turn.
Ready for pressurization?
Now to Glenn falls the challenge of man's next advance into space, for he has been chosen to cross the threshold gained by Shepard and Grissom and to orbit the world. So the countdown continues for John Glenn. And it continues beyond this room for Friendship 7. And it continues this moment around the world. Into history. Glenn is the astronaut, the man who will challenge space. But he is just one member of an international scientific endeavor that requires the genius and skills of some 40,000 other men and women scattered throughout the world. From the engineers and technicians who produce the space vehicle to the crews now preparing to launch it. From the tracking experts who will chart his voyage around the globe to the sailors now waiting at sea to recover him. Behind this day stands years of preparation, of research and testing, of planning and training. And the purpose of it all is knowledge. Knowledge of space and of how effectively man and spacecraft can function together in its hostile environment. Knowledge that will serve as the basis for space explorations of the future. Hard-won knowledge of benefit to all men, bought by sacrifice and dedication and courage. Now, just a handful of minutes remain until the spacecraft crew on the service tower call for the pilot of Friendship 7. The countdown is their master plan, and they proceed through its ritual with unhurried deliberation. Its pages contain the timetable of order they must follow to awaken a giant machine, to test its readiness, and to prime it for the one supreme moment for which it was created.
ISO now, meter reads 19 volts. Bravo standby on. Now meter reads 11.5. 6 volt
Mercury stations reported go.
Special equipment has been installed here at the press site for them to tell their story to the world, to their own newspapers, and for their some radio stations from Latin America that are here.
All stations. Gantry is in launch position. AMR, CNS band beacons are on. Start interrogation in 1 minute.
Be with you, Thomas.
Good Lord, ride all the way. Godspeed, John Glenn.
1 hour, 2, 1 hour, 1, oxygen 78, 100, amps 2, 7.
Then much more rapidly as it gained speed with altitude. After 2 minutes, booster engine cutoff occurred as programmed, and the booster section was jettisoned. The escape tower, now unneeded, was also jettisoned. 5 minutes after launch, the space vehicle at an altitude of 100 miles, SECO, sustainer engine cutoff. The spacecraft was released from the launch vehicle, and the posigrade rockets fired.
Roger, 0G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous. You can see the booster during turnaround just a couple of hundred yards behind me. It was beautiful.
Roger, 7. You have a go. At least 7 orbits. Roger, understand go for at least 7 orbits. The Friendship 7 can see clear back a big cloud pattern way back across toward the Cape.
At the end of the first orbit, a thruster malfunction permitted only partial use of the automatic stabilization and control system. Astronaut Glenn took over and controlled the spacecraft manually. The second orbit over Mouchet, Australia, a ground telemetry signal indicated that the heat shield might be loose. A decision was made by Mercury Control to program re-entry with the retro rocket package in place. And astronaut Glenn was instructed to manually override the automatic jettison mechanism.
Roger, say again your instructions, please. Over.
We are recommending that the retro package not, I say again, not be jettisoned. This means that you will have to override the 05
correcting scope manually.
While you're doing that, we're not sure whether or not your landing bag has deployed. We feel it's far safer to re-enter with the retro package on. We see no difficulty at this time in that type of re-entry. Over.
Roger. Understand. You're going out.
We recommend that you...
Coming down on 10, snorkels are open.
Roger.
Main chute is on green. Chute is out in reach condition at 10,800 feet in. Beautiful chute. Looks good. On O2 emergency, and the chute looks very good. Rate of descent has gone to about 42 feet per second. The chute looks very good. Hello, Mercury Recovery. This is Friendship 7. Do you receive? Friendship 7, the chute looks very good. Over.
Astronaut Glenn and his spacecraft, Friendship 7, landed well within the planned recovery area. All mission objectives had been achieved, including a realization of the primary goal of the Mercury program, to put a man in orbit around the Earth and recover him safely. But the MA-6 flight had done even more. It had demonstrated conclusively that man was a necessary requirement for space flight to implement decisions beyond ground control limits, to supplement automated systems with his reason and technical skill. The scope of manned space flight had been enlarged.
Follow tomorrow, and in the tomorrows after that, each step more bold as we reach out to explore the universe around us.
Glenn Jr., everywhere bedlam is breaking loose down here. People are waiting, trying to be able to find John Glenn. America is proud of you. Welcome, John. Hi, John.
Today, I know that I seem to be standing alone on this great platform. Just as I seem to be alone in the cockpit of the Friendship 7 spacecraft. But I'm not. There were with me then and with me now thousands of Americans and many hundreds of citizens of many countries around the world who contributed to this truly international undertaking voluntarily and in a spirit of cooperation and understanding. On behalf of all those people, I would like to express my and their heartfelt thanks for the honors you have bestowed upon us here today. We are all proud to have been privileged to be part of this effort to represent our country as we have. As our knowledge of this universe in which we live increases, may God grant us the wisdom and guidance to use it wisely. Thank you.